العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Last time we stopped with Bab with Hadith 294, right?
Yes.
New chapter, Bab. So this one they pronounce al-luqta أو al-luqata. يعني some of the علماء they call it luqta, or some of the علماء say luqata. By the language should be luqta. But there's a lot of our fuqaha, they use it luqata with fatah, so it's okay. Luqata or luqata is okay. Same meaning. What's the meaning of luqata? The hadith عن زيد بن خالد الجهني رضي الله عنه قال سئل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن لقطة الذهب أو الورق قال اعرف وكاءها وعفاصها ثم عرفها سنة فإن لم تعرف فاستنفقها ولتكن وديعة عندك فإن جاء طالبها يوما من الدهر فأديها إليه وسأله عن ضالة الإبل فقال ما لك وما لها. The long hadith. The meaning of the hadith, اللقطة or اللقطة means the thing that we find. Sometimes you find money, find gold, whatever you find.
Lost items.
So then, this is they call it luqta or luqata. Luqta or luqata. So Rasulullah ﷺ, someone asked him about luqata. And Rasulullah ﷺ, first, when you get luqata, first you have to know it well. I mean, look to it, see what it is, memorize the description, everything about it. And then you have to tell people about it, but don't tell them the description. For example, you find money. You tell people, I find something. If anyone lost things, come to me. And this one, you have to do it for 1 year.
So you have to keep it?
Keep it with you. And then after you keep it, you tell people, I find something. And then this one you have to tell people when the people normally, public area, I mean when most people will hear or will know about it. Maybe masjid, maybe during Jum'ah prayer, maybe, okay? Or maybe you put notice in the market or whatever. And then when people come to you, ask them, what did you lose? Okay, money, how much? And then you ask him about all these things. Then if that's the person, you give back to that person. After 1 year, then we will tell the details later. But here, our ulama, first we talk about, it is compulsory to take it or not? This is the question. So there is a details, and also there's different madhab have different opinion. But since we are here Shafi'i, we'll talk about Shafi'i. Shafi'i said, if the luqata, or luqta, as we said, the item can be spoiled if lifted, that it is compulsory to take it. Like, for example, it is food. Okay? So if you leave it there, it's going to be spoiled. And then you have to take it. You have no choice. Or any items can be spoiled if lifted. Maybe you find it on the road. Maybe there's some items, if we leave it on the road, maybe because of the sun or the rain, it will be spoiled, right? So Shafi'i said, then in this case, you compulsory to take it.
Raw material.
Yeah. Any material that can be spoiled. Then you have no choice, you have to take it, and you have to keep it with you, and you have to do the process, which is ta'rif. Ta'rif means you have to inform people that you find something. The other madhab, some of them they say mustahab, and mean it's preferred, but it's not compulsory. And there is a cases where is don't take it, makruh. And some cases muharram, it means prohibited. Anything in Mecca, you find you have no way to take it, even as a luqata. In Mecca, anything you find, you leave it there. Okay, this is Mecca. So in Mecca, it is prohibited to to get anything lost, you find it there, you cannot get it. Just leave it. And makruh means when the item in a way or in a place that maybe when the owner come back will find it. Then the ulama say makruh. Okay? Maybe, okay, but let us say there is a plastic bag. Someone left it, for example, beside the house or beside the door or
umbrella
or whatever. Okay, so maybe the owner will come back to get it, right? So don't take it. This is makruh to take it here. Because maybe the owner, there's opportunity, the owner will come back and take it, and it will not be spoiled, then makruh to take it. So it means, in the end, what we can say, you decide what is the best for the item. What is the best for the item? Okay, to leave it or to take it. You judge that. If you find that is the best for the item to be taken, take it. If not, then leave it. So this is, I mean, from the beginning, should we take it or we should leave it? Then if we decide we have to take it, then there is another process. The first process, we have to announce to the people. And the announcement should be for 1 year. If the item will not be spoiled, like you find, for example, something can be spoiled easily, and then 1 year you have to announce to the people for 1 year, you keep it with you as amana. After 1 year, what we should do. Here also, the ulama have a different opinion, but all of them agree that it is not belong to you. I mean, this is the agreement of all madhab. No madhab said it is not belong to you. But now, can I use it or cannot? So the ulama, they say, you can use it, but in a different madhab, different, hukum. Example. Al-Imam Malik said, the best, what is preferred, don't use it. Alaykum as-salam. Imam Malik said, the best, don't use it, just keep it with you. Don't use it. The other method is like Shafi'i, Ahmad Muhammad, they say, use it. But it is amana. But you are allowed to use it. Means when the owner come, you have to give back. If, for example, you clothes or something, you use it that cannot be used again, you have to pay what is equal to money to the owner when the owner come back.
Even if you have reached 1 year, keeping the item.
After 1 year, this is one after 1 year. Before 1 year, you cannot use it.
Okay.
Before 1 year, you are not allowed to use it. Unless we said it can be spoiled. Well, it can be spoiled, you can use it before 1 year. Because if food, you cannot keep it for 1 year. Right? We'll come to this one. If we use it before 1 year, what we should do. But now we talk about after 1 year, mean, let us say I find a handphone. So I keep the handphone with me for 1 year, I did not use. That after 1 year, after I tell people, make announcement, and no one come, then I can use the handphone. But when I use it, now it is not mine. It is amana with me, but I am allowed to use it. Means when the owner of that come, and he give me all the specification of the phone, then I have to give that phone back to that person. If that phone is spoiled with me, because I use it,
forgive.
No, I have to pay money. What? How much it worth, I have to pay back to that person. So this is mean after 1 year.
But we use normal, but because we use it over time, it becomes old and not fashion anymore. But we use normal.
But if it's still working, you just give back.
Okay, but the function is not so good as the new one.
Because of what?
Because of being old.
A handphone, the software is out of date, right? It is not your mistake.
Okay.
So you just give up. This is your phone, you take it.
Okay, how about wallet?
Same.
Wallet, over time, it will...
Then you have to be...
Even though it's not our fault.
Yeah. Unless you just keep it, you did not use.
Okay.
If you just keep it without use, even by the time it is spoiled, then it is not your mistake. But now we talk about if you use it, you use the wallet, and of course that one will spoil the wallet, then you have to pay the, what is it called?
Okay. The amount, the same amount or the current amount?
No, in that time how much it worth, and then you
Like new one.
I mean that type, in that time, how much it worth.
Okay.
You pay.
Okay.
So we only pay if the owner comes and...
Yes.
If it gets torn out, as we are using the item, do we have to, replace or pay somewhere?
Sorry?
For example, we decide to use after 1 year.
Uh-huh.
So we have to... Then the item gets in a damage.
Mm.
So do we have to...
Yeah, if the item damaged because you use it...
But no one claims after 1 year.
No, that's what... If no one claims, that's it. It's for you.
It's fine.
It's for you.
This can still can use it, but it's still not ours.
Yeah. So don't use. You can use it till you die, or the item is spoiled.
Okay. The owner came on the second use.
You have to give it back to him.
Let's say,
it's spoiled. Maybe 3 years, 4 years. Then the owner's come.
You have to pay the amount that equal. How much that item equal in that time? You give to him.
So let's say you found S7, let's say Samsung S7, and then 3 years after, so now S10 already.
Yeah.
S7, the price already changed. Now we pay the price of S7 at
that time.
Or now?
Now.
When the owner comes.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, so it's lower price.
Yeah.
That means you can consider the devalue of the product?
Yeah, of course. Because it's not your mistake. That, what is it, if it's your mistake, then that's it. But it is not your mistake because the value now is already go down. Mm-hmm. So this is the lokat. And then they say, for example, if the things can be spoiled. If the thing can be spoiled, you can use it before 1 year. Like if it is food, for example, or any other time should be used in that time. You can use it, and then, for example, food, you can eat it. And then the how much it worth, the money will be for the owner when the owner come.
For the food, how long does it wait, waiting period?
Before it is spoiled. If in 1 day, you can eat it within 1 day.
Oh.
Yeah, so it depends on... Because you know, so some type of food can stay with you 1 year, right?
Yeah. So one question.
Yes.
How do we classify whether this is a lost item or maybe a treasure? For example, you go to a jungle and then you find
A
gold ring.
This is also, you have the culture of the people will decide that. If it is a road, then it is not a treasure. If it is a market, you find it in the market, then it is not treasure. Okay? If the land belongs to someone, then it is not a treasure. Okay? But when you find it in the land, it does not belong to anyone. Okay? Then it is treasure.
So we can take it.
Yeah. Use it, claim it as treasure because you have to, 20% you have to pay it as zakat, and then...
20%?
Yeah. 20%. Yeah.
Oh, for treasure.
Mm. Okay. You have to pay 20% to the Amir al-Mu'mineen.
Okay.
This is a right of the government, 20%.
What's different? Okay, because the treasure is sometimes in the form of germs, right? Gold.
Mm.
Right. So, how to difference between? Differentiate between
Lokata.
And I heard the words Milki Amr.
Oh, Milki
Amr. Public properties. People properties.
Okay. Because actually, this is a new term. Last time, during Rasulullah's time, when the land is not belong to anyone. And inside that land, you find something worthy, like gold, like whatever, then we call it treasure. Treasure does not mean gold. anything worth money. Okay, mean have a value.
Petroleum, like
today. Whatever.
Natural gases. Ah.
Okay.
When I have my first born son, I shave the hair and then give it to the zakat center. They wrote it down in kota.
Sorry.
The price, the money that I gave them for charity, they wrote it down in the receipt in kota.
No, it's not luqata.
It's a
sadaqah. This is sadaqah. It's not zakah, sadaqah. Charity sadaqah.
Yeah.
Because they weigh the hair with the what scale? Whether it's a gold, want to donate gold, silver, or.
Yeah, but it is not luqata. Luqata means have no owner. We don't know who is the owner. This is the meaning of luqata. Luqata means something worth money, have a value, but have no owner, but it should belong to owner. Mean it is not a treasure, it is not hidden underground, or not, means normally this thing or this item definitely should belong to someone. This is the meaning of luqata.
Treasure, different.
So what if that person is poor and he found food? And if they say he eats and then the owner comes, repay. He does not have the money.
Then it is dain. The money will be dain.
Debt.
Yeah. Till you can pay.
I see.
So I think you don't finish yet, right? About the milki amma.
Milki amma. So what is milki amma? Milki amma means now. I give you an example. When the Muslim come to from Arabic Peninsula to Iraq. You know, this is there is a desert. There's no water, no trees, nothing. And they come to Iraq. So when they come to Iraq, they conquer the first two towns, which is Basra and Kufa. So Basra in that time is a jungle like Malaysia. It's a full jungle. Okay? But there's no people living there. You got the idea? It's a jungle like any jungle here, but no one lives there. So when the Muslim conquer this air, this land, which is fully of trees, fruits, and so on, so this one should be distributed to the soldiers, right?
Soldiers.
Because this is the Islam, when we give to the soldiers, right? Umar al-Khattab decide this one will be kept as milkiya amma, public property. Because Umar said, I want to sponsor the armies, I want to build the new towns, I want to, you know, help the Muslim in Arabic Peninsula. They have give salary to their families because, you know, they are fighting. In that time, the soldiers, when they fight, they have no salary. In that time, people go jihad voluntarily. But they left family behind them, right? So who will sponsor the families? The only one who sponsors them is Amir al-Mu'mineen, right? So all these need money, and Umar al-Khattab in that time don't have income. Because even zakat, in that time, what is the zakat? All the Muslim fighting, no one doing business. You got the idea?
Yeah.
So in that time, all the man needed in the army, and the old man, you know, they just went back out to fight free only for Islam. No one of them asking for money or for salaries. But the family is left behind, need someone to sponsor them. So Umar al-Khattab bring money from where? That's why they call it as Ard al-Sawad, if you hear about it. So Ard al-Sawad means the black area, because when the Muslims come from the desert, they see it as black. Because a lot of trees, like a jungle, you know, from distance you see it as black, right? They call it black area. So Umar said this area is kept for public property. And then Umar give, for example, you can work a farmer, go work as a farmer in this one. We give you a salary, and the product is for the government. So this is what you call it, milkiya amma. Okay. So, for example, during Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam time, also after that, Abu Bakr and Umar, they do the same with the Khulafa. There is they have camels, animals belong to the government. They use it at that time because when they go to the war, they use the camels, horses, all this, right? So there is some animals that belong to the government to use it So, but these animals need to eat, need, so, not like today. So they need a place, is only for them to eat. So then, Amir al-Mu'mineen, that Rasulullah or the Khulafa after that, they said, this land, no one allowed to bring his animal here.
Government land.
Government land. It's only for the animals of the government to eat from the grass in that area. So now this area become public property. No one allowed to touch. So this is the meaning of public property.
But no one allowed to touch.
Yeah, no one allowed to eat from it.
Property there.
You cannot bring your animal, your private animal, to eat there. This is the meaning no one allowed to touch.
Everyone can use that.
Sorry?
Everyone can use
that. Use it as what? Because this man meant when the grass come out here, that grass will be eaten by the government animal. So if you go there, you are going to spoil the land, you are going to spoil the grass. So this is the meaning of public property.
Then, Ustaz, how about this unclaimed property?
Means?
When people die or something, they did not do wasi or what. So we have this pool of, well, like, which is 60 billion or what, that, you know, the warita semua, they just not claim. So they are not using this money, it's like,
So the idea here, because that money is not belong to the government, belong to the warith.
Yeah.
And each man, each person have a warith, unless he have no family at all, right?
No. Kala.
Yeah. So if the person have no warith at all, the money will go to the government.
Baitul mal.
Yeah, it is Baitul mal. But if the person have warith but did not claim, and then Amir al-Mu'mineen will take the money, put it in Baitul mal for them. Keep it in Baitul mal for them. I mean, when they come to claim, they take it.
Exactly.
There's not Luqata.
Luqata,
because this is, we know the warith.
Okay.
But the warith did not claim. Maybe he traveled, maybe, but he, we know who is the warith, right? For example, I die. I have my son now in Switzerland. I die in Malaysia, right? So maybe my son did not know I have money here. But the people here know that I have son in Switzerland. I mean, when he come, he will get the money. This is the idea. So luqata means we find a place not in a protected area. Like this one, the waris, when I die, my money is in a protected area. And everyone know it's belong to me. So this is not luqata. Luqata means we find the money in a place that not protected. It's a public area. So this is the meaning of luqata.
If you find all the coins, is that a...
Very good idea. The ulama said, if the item, the value, normally people did not claim or don't look for, you can even use it without tarif, without tearing.
You didn't compensate. You
didn't for example, you find 20 cents. This one, no need to say it's belong to, you just go and use it. Because people normally don't claim or don't look for these things.
If I'm not mistaken, they say 3 days.
No, there is no. They said if the worth of that items, normally in that culture, in that area, people did not, go back and look for it because it did not worth. Okay, then that one you can just use it.
So like in Malacca, one certain they like
flip a coin.
Throw coins. This kurafa thing. So we can throw the coin.
This is the because if that meant for khilafa, that money become prohibited.
Then how about these Chinese people? They put like this, sweets and then oranges. And then what's again?
Not allowed to eat. Even they give to you. Even after that they give to you, you are not allowed to eat.
Previously they take that. All the village people will take all the Chinese offering.
No, cannot. Because it's meant for Shirk.
Shirk.
So it's a prohibit.
Well, it's food.
Yeah, this is the idea. In the Quran, Allah mentions the food.
Yeah.
Any food meant for not, for yeah. You are not allowed to eat.
That's
why just. At least darura, that's a different story.
Plastic now. Plastic oranges, plastic.
So this is the luqata. Of course, there is, for example, sometimes books. Okay? And then, same story. You can keep it with you, you can use it. Okay, there's another thing. If you decide to give it as sadaqah.
If you find a book, you can use it?
You can use it. No, if the book from the type that people normally look for it, search for it, then it is luqata. But if book, like our book, reading book, that we, so no one will claim, so.
they put outside the door.
Yeah, yeah, because no one uses it actually. For them, it's not worthy actually, yeah.
So we can use them.
Yeah, this one we can use. Because it is not worthy. But sometimes, for example, a book, which is a precious book. Old book, now old book, but it is, I mean, if you sell it in the market, people will fight to get it. A different story. Last time we went to the Hajj with the UAE, and then they a group of lecturers, 30 of us, we went to Medina during the Hajj, the UAE group. And we went to the Medina, they invite us to go to the place when they bring the Quran, Mus'haf al-Medina. This is not Mus'haf al-Medina, because there is a huge village. Very big place. They printing Al Quran. The Quran is in Saudi one. Yeah. And we went there. They took us, and then because we are from UAE, and then special group, and then that time the whole group sponsored by the son of King Fahad. And that time was King Fahad the king. His son, Abdul Aziz bin Fahad, he sponsored the whole trip. So because we come, you know, they give us a special volume of Quran, which is from outside is we call it painted by gold, real gold. Only the outside, only the outside
layer.
Yeah. So it is like painting, okay, by gold. So it's very, very precious one. So it's like, so now you cannot just claim it. If you find this one, special version of the Quran. They said from that one, they printed out only 10,000. Yeah, and that one did not offer. This only to be given as a gift when the king order, under the order of the king.
How much is it?
I don't know, like that. I don't know. It's not for sale. Definitely, it's not for sale. So this is. I mean, sometimes you have like books like this one. And also, if you give sadaqah, you decide to give that luqata as sadaqah, and after that, the owner come. And then here, it depends on the owner. If he approve your sadaqah, he will get the ajr. If he did not approve, the sadaqah will be for you, and you have to pay to the owner.
But not both get the ajr.
Of course, if that approve, you will get the ajr, of course, because you are the reason for the sadaqah. But if that person decides, he say, no, I want my item back. And then he will get zero from the sadaqah, he will get zero, he will get nothing. So you will get the full ajr of sadaqah, and you give him his money back. This is the luqata. So this is a new chapter now, 295, Bab al-Wasaya. Wasiya, wasiyat? You say wasiya in Malaysia?
Yeah,
wasiya.
Wasiya.
An Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu anhuma, anna Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qal, ma haqq mri'in muslim, lahu shay'in yusi fih, yabitu laylatayni illa wasiyatuhu maktubatan indah. Zada Muslim, ما مرت علي ليلة منذ سمعت الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول ذلك إلا وعندي وصيتي. The meaning of the hadith, الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم said here, any Muslim, it is a right, it is mean compulsory for the Muslim. It is a duty of the Muslim. If he have something to be given as a wasiyah, he cannot sleep for two continuous nights without writing his wasiyah. And from that hadith, there is a huge debate here. Is the wasiyah compulsory or not? So some of the ulama, they said it is compulsory that any Muslim should write his wasiyah. Some of the ulama, they say it is not compulsory, it is preferred to write our wasiyah. And there is other ulama, they say, no, it is not like that. It is when you have something. Means, I have money, but I don't want to give to anyone. I want my wallet to take it as a normal. So why I should write my wasiyah? Mean here we write wasiyah when we want to give only. So if that my intention, I want to give something, for example, okay, I have money, I want to give 10% or 5% of that money if I die to my nephew, for example, because my nephew will not be worried. I have son, I have... Sorry? Yeah, this is like a, because when the person write, when I die, people take it. This one we don't call it hiba, we call it wasiyah. So wasiyah means the hiba or the gift that you give after you die. So how people know? Then you have to write it. You have to write that wasiyah. You tell people that when I die, okay, for example, that person give him that, okay, you things, for example. You have, for example, watch. I want this watch to be to my friend. You have Rolex.
Maximum 1/3.
1/3, yeah, this is the maximum. Wasiyah, maximum is 1/3. This is the next hadith, actually.
Oh, nice.
So here we talk about this is compulsory or not. So this is how our ulama said. Some of the ulama say it's compulsory, wajib. Like Ibn Umar took it as compulsory.
Right. Compulsory,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Mean you have to write. Even you don't want to give, you said my money will be divided as the warith they taught. Okay.
Right here means what? Because sometimes we under the bank, we have this kind of service of, you know, writing wasiyah. We cannot write manually on ourselves, or this one referring to we can write on our own.
Wasiyah can actually in Islam can be written or can be telling to the people with witness.
But you must have witnesses.
Yes.
Proof.
Yeah. Mean you tell people, this is my wasiyah. So you are, for example, two person.
So in our contact, it has to be done properly.
You have to write here, for example, Malaysia.
Yeah.
Actually, this one will be better. Actually, if you write it handily and witness, this one will be better. But still, wasiyah can be verbally, and then you need witness here.
They have a panel for this kind of.
Yes, yeah, so this service. This,
yeah.
We have to pay actually.
It's okay. No problem with that. No problem. Yeah, this one no problem. Actually, this one better because this one will prevent from, you know, people from fighting. Because sometimes I can bring some people. They say, "Oh, I have witness," and I pay them. They can, you know, I take 1/3 of your money, right? So that's why if we have the government make that department, it will be better actually, to organize these things.
So Shafi'i is wajib or sunnah?
Wallahi did not search here for the which madhab say what.
Oh.
But this is a three opinion. One opinion, it is compulsory. You have to write wasiyah. Does it matter you will leave something or not? You have to write. Other people say, they say it is not compulsory, it is preferred.
Afdal.
Yeah. The third group, they said, no, it is compulsory for you when you have something to tell, okay, or to give. Okay, then you're right. Only in that case. So this is three different opinions in the case. So.
So for you, which one is the stronger? You yourself?
Well, I have no money to leave to anyone. So.
What, your car?
What? You have money,
lah. Yeah. Actually, I go for the third one, because it will be difficult for everyone to write his wasiyah. So. And maybe also you can change your mind. When you write your wasiyah, maybe it's difficult to change your mind after that. So
wasiyah, So what is about giving your property to somebody? Can we include, for example, our debts in our wasiyah as well?
No, the warith, you cannot write wasiyah to warith.
So for example, who will be taking care of our debts and our loans and...
Sorry?
Loan.
No, this one, no need was here, because this one, before we divide the money, we have to settle all your debts. This one, you write was here or not? Actually, when some person died, when someone died, the qadi, the first thing the qadi will do, will keep all the money and will ask if he have a debt. So before do anything, before even he have wasiyah, to give money to someone, before they give anything, first you have to settle the debt. If something left it, then we talk.
But if not left, and it is
khalas.
The debt is still covered. The debt is still not covered, let's say.
That's khalas.
Oh, then the person will not receive their money. Lah.
Who?
The
warith will go to zero.
The warith have to pay?
No.
Oh.
If they want to pay, it is not compulsory. Okay. Just to say, because, okay, this is the idea. Now when I die, and I have debt, let us to say my debt is 1 million. Let us to say that. I go business, I lost in the business, for example. And then my debt become 1 million. Then when I left, I have my house, they sold my house, my car, so it's 700,000. There's 300,000 left in. So this 300,000 belong to a people. If they cannot get it in the dunya, they will get it from me in the akhirah. Of course. Oh. Nothing will be...
warith cannot help to...
So that's why I hear, if my warith love me, of course they will not put me, will put me in the trouble in the day after, my children, for example, or my... So in this case...
Doesn't mean the responsibility is not
your
to pay.
Yeah, it's not compulsory for you to pay. Yeah, it's not compulsory for you.
Charity for them.
Yeah, it's for them. If they save me, okay, of course Allah will give them a lot of ajr, because this one considered as al birr, right? If they march children, it's birr al waliday, right?
But if you don't pay, it's not hukuk, right?
No.
It's not hukuk waliday, right?
If you have. Now, if you have the money and you can pay your father debt, be careful. Because Allah will ask you a very hard question. Prepare your question. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned many times in the Quran, I'm going to ask you, be ready. So everything you do in the dunya, prepare your answer, because Allah will ask you about it. So prepare your answer before you die. Write it, okay? If Allah asks me about it, this is my answer. Make it clear. Okay, last hadith today. عن سعد بن أبي وقاص رضي الله عنه قال جاءني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يعودني عام حجة الوداع من وجع اشتد بي فقلت يا رسول الله قد بلغ بي من الوجع ما ترى وأنا ذو مال ولا يرثني إلا ابنه فأتصدق بثلثي مالي قال لا قلت فالشطر يا رسول الله قال لا قلت فالثلث قال الثلث والثلث كثير إنك لن تنفق نفقة تبتغي أجرت بها حتى ما تجعل في امرأتك قال قلت يا رسول الله أخلف بعد أصحابي قال إنك لن تخلف فتعمل عملا تبتغي بوجه الله إلا زدت به درجة ورفع ولا لك أن تخلف حتى ينتفع بك أقواما ويضر بك أقوام اللهم ضل أصحابي هجرتهم ولا تردهم على عقابي لكن البائس سابع على يرضي الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم إن مات في مكة. طيب the hadith, the meaning of the hadith that سعد بن أبي وقاص, you know سعد بن أبي وقاص, one of the tenth that in Hajjat al-Wada, I mean, he got sick, very sick. And the sick was very, very difficult or very hard. So people thought he's going to die. So Rasulullah ﷺ visited him. So at that time, Sa'd ibn Waqqas have only one daughter. Don't have a son. But after that, he got well and he married again and he got children and he got son. And his son, Umar bin Sa'ad, the one of those who fight against Al-Husayn in the Battle of Karbala. Okay, Umar bin Sa'ad. Anyway, I mean, but see, this is a human being. At that time, he thought, I'm going to die. And then I have a lot of money, and I have only one daughter, so I want to give most of my money as a sadaqah. So he came to Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told him, he said, Ya Rasulullah, I want to give 2/3 of my money as a sadaqah, because I have only one daughter. So 1/3 is a lot for her, so, because Sa'ad was very rich. And Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, no. 2/3, a lot. And I said, okay, half. He said, no. And he said, okay, 1/3. And Rasulullah Sallam, 1/3, okay, but still a lot. but still a lot. Thuluth was thuluthu kathir. You mean Rasulullah Sallam allowed us to give thuluth, but he said, even that thuluth is still a lot, but you can do it. Mean this is the maximum we can do. We cannot go beyond a third.
1/3.
1/3. So it means when we die, we can write wasiyah, and wasiyah that 1/3 of our properties or wealth will go as wasiyah to people that we mention, or sadaqah to, in general, I mean, to Amir al-Mu'mineen, he divide.
Was it Rasulullah means not recommend 1/3?
Not recommend, this means it's still a lot. Yeah, means because of this hadith narrated in a different way. He said to leave your children rich better than you leave them poor. Because this hadith have another narration. In that hadith, Rasulullah Sallam, your children.
Same
hadith, but narrated in a different book. Rasulullah Sallam told Sa'ad, if you leave your children rich, better than you leave them poor, asking people to help them. So it means, Rasulullah he said, if you have money, leave it to your children. But if you want to give sadaqah, don't give sadaqah in a way that make your children poor or needy or not really rich, you know, so, okay? If you have money to make them rich, okay, leave it to them. Let them to, after that, they use it after you. Means when you give, don't give a mawan that affect the wealth behind you in a bad way or something like that. So this is the meaning of the hadith. And then from that hadith, we are allowed to give this wasiyah. But there is a condition, it is not mentioned here, that warith cannot, you write wasiyah to warith. You cannot write wasiyah. Means, I cannot write wasiyah that 1/3 of my money go to my father.
They will get.
Because they are part of
it. Because my father is warith. When I die, okay, my father will be warith, right?
But is still wrote, is it valid or what?
Not valid. Even you write it, not valid. Will be cancelled. Or for example, I say to my wife, she 1/3 will go to my wife. I know, or one of my son, okay?
Or dog, cat?
No.
Cannot, right?
In Islam, cannot. Only for a human.
This is...
Animals is not a warith.
I mean, wasiyah.
Yeah, even wasiyah.
Cannot.
Yeah.
Oh, sir, the witness have signed the name.
Sorry?
Even when he give wasiyah.
To warith.
To the warith. But they are two witnesses, they just signed.
Even 1,000,000 witness. Because this one again is the rule of Islam. Because there is hadith, Rasulullah said, La wasiyyata li warith. So it's clearly said, La wasiyyata li warith. So you cannot do it.
Even the company that are appointed to become the trustee.
Does it matter, brother?
No.
Does it matter? In Islam, it is very clear. If a warith, you are not allowed, Rasulullah said clearly, if there is a warith, you are not allowed to give wasiyah to him. So if you say, I want to break the rule, the qadi will not follow you, because you are against the rule of Islam.
So that agreement will
void. Damn. will be approved only in one condition. When all the warith allowed your wasiyah. This is the only way that your wasiyah will be approved.
If there's only one warith?
Khalas.
Oh.
All of them should.
No, I mean, there's only one warith.
Ah.
There's no other siblings.
Doesn't matter.
So can.
Can what?
Can, that means the wasiyah can be done to one warith.
No, cannot. What is this idea? Because here, the idea here, when you die, warith will take the share that Allah decided to him or to her.
Fara'id.
That's it. You cannot give more by wasiyah.
They use it another one. They say hibah before dying.
This is the idea. The idea, if you hibah, you have to give it before you die. You cannot say, this is hibah to Shamsuddin after I die. You cannot say that. Because when you say that, it's become wasiyah.
I know, it's becoming confused. They're trying to play by the system.
So because this idea, the difference between hibah and wasiyah, hibah you're giving when you are alive. So this is the hibah.
So that means the ownership change.
During your life.
During your life.
Yeah. But when you say the ownership will be changed after I die, it becomes wasiyah. Okay? You put it as a gift, you put it in any way. The term here does not matter.
But now, into this context, the hibah basically is practiced in a way that when you die and you basically reserve some amounts of your money or your wealth to your warith basically.
This one not allowed.
But
this one not allowed because this one become wasiyah.
Yeah, there's no. If I'm not mistaken, there has been like practices.
Here.
When you die, then you have to give some portions of your wealth.
To whom?
To anyone that you have put the names in.
Even warith.
Yeah. I can't remember. I don't know.
No.
That's what has been practiced.
No, not allowed.
Maybe our
sorry?
Our sister, yeah.
Madam, last time we talked about that. Even now the riba, they changed the name of the riba to murabaha. Changing the name will not change the situation. Now when I drink alcohol and I call it water, okay, it become a water, it is alcohol. So it doesn't matter. Name, how, because this is not only now. During the history, people try to manipulate the situation because they want to give money to some people.
Now, so everything.
So that's why when you die, all your wealth will be given as fara'id. Those people who have fara'id, you are not allowed to give them extra. They will take what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give to them.
Now they cheat, right?
Now, I, for example, let's say one of them, I have one of my son, he's disabled. While the rest can work, can do business, but that person or that girl, disabled. So I want to guarantee that she will have more share because she is disabled. So in this case, what I will do, I will bring the warith. Okay, I'll tell them, okay, I'm going to do that. I'm going to write it to wasiyah to them. Do you agree or not? If they agree, I bring witness. Okay, they agree, sign. That's it.
Must be done when you are alive.
Or you can write it. And when you die, the qadi will ask them, do you approve or not? Even in my life, I did not take their agreement. But when I die, the qadi will say, okay, this is wasiyah, but this wasiyah again is the law of Islam. But can be approved if you allow it. Why? Because you are the share holder. So if you allowed your share to be minus and to be given to this one, so now it becomes sadaqah from those people to that person.
So that means approve or not, this depends on the, after you die,
yeah.
Depend on the
warith. Those people, the warith. They allowed or not?
Not the time you ask.
No, if in your time you ask them and they agree, that's it. They, even if you die, they cannot reverse. Because they agree on the sadaqah, and the sadaqah when you give, you cannot take it back. That's it.
What if when you die, they want to change their mind?
If there is a witness, no one listens to them.
Oh.
That's why you have to make witness. Because if there is no witness, no one can prove that you they already give sadaqah. Because in this case, they already give sadaqah, right? Mm-hmm. That's why they cannot bring it by. Why? Because they already agreed to give this money as a sadaqah, right? So now, if you have a witness, those people already give that money as a sadaqah, then they cannot take it back. This is the idea. But to play, around that it is hiba during my life. Even last week, we talked about hadith, right? There is a person, he gave his son money, hadiyah. But see, because the mother is a good Muslim. And that person, he have another children from another wife. So he give to the son, one of his son, he give him money. The mother of that son, she tells him, no. First you ask Rasulullah, is this one allowed or not allowed? See, this is a good Muslim. This is a good believer. Even for here, it is good, right? Because he gives her son. You get it? But for here, if it is haram, I will not allow my son to take it. Go and ask Rasulullah. Then he went to Rasulullah. We took this hadith last week, right? Then he went to Rasulullah and he said, Ya Rasulullah, well, this is what I did. I gave my son money as a hiba, as a gift. I want you to be witness on that. And Rasulullah said, wait. Did you give other son? Do you have another son? He said, yes, I have another children. Do you give them the same? And he said, no. And Rasulullah said, this is unjust. I will not be witness on something unjust.
This is because of different mother?
No. Doesn't matter.
So even same mother?
Same mother. It's not fair. You are not fair, that's it. Rasulullah said, you are not fair.
Not fair to your son.
Yeah, to them. So that's why Rasulullah said, you want me to be witness in this case? It is unjust. And I cannot be witness on unjust things.
This is considered hibah during the life, no?
Of course. Hibah during the life. But this one, why? Because this is the idea. Because what you are doing, because all of them waris. When you during your life give one hiba and you did not give others, you are just making a hatred between them.
Yes.
This is what happened. But when you give someone outside, not from the family, it's a different story. You got it? This is not worry. This is not, that money will not mean when I die, you will take your share. So this one is out. It will not take more than you. But if I imagine, why you give my brother or you did not give to me? When you die, he will take the same share with me, plus the gift that you give to him. It's not fair to me. This is the idea. That's why, for example, a person, let us say a man or a lady, she have no children. Can she donate all her money? No. Also, what's that? But see, I have no children. Your father, my father, my mother, both of them pass away. And my husband pass away.
The sibling of
the party. Yeah, so your brother and sister, this is their money now. So you are not allowed to donate all your money. You can donate only one third. The rest is belong to them. You have to ask their permission first. Before you do. So these are the things, I mean, how...
Let's say a father doesn't have a son, only daughters. Mm. And then he have a stepbrother.
So you have
yes,
this
one. Yes. Oh. You have three more stepbrothers or other from a different mother.
Same. Because they are going to be warith, right?
Warith. So? But he wants to make sure that the daughter get more than the.
This is the idea. Are you more merciful than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is the idea. When Allah decides, when you die, your daughters will take that and your brother will take that. And you say, oh, this is not fair for my daughter. I want to give to all. How you deal with Allah? You get it? That's why you. This is what Allah decides. You have to accept. Doesn't matter what. So this is what you have today. If you have any question or any...